Okay. So, well, do you remember where it is, which page? No, that's okay.
Yeah, that I think some similar.
Oh, I see. Yeah, so he says, look, this looks, this may appear startling to you, but to make it more startling, now I can't do that experiment here. Maybe one can, I don't know. Look at the plot in reverse time. What does reverse time mean? Reverse time means that, you know, after all, you suppose you start push your origin here. I mean, see, this is a sequence of heads and tails. You're like, okay, first of all, let me just explain what the plots are. X-axis is number of tosses, heads and tails, and the plot shows the excess of heads over tails. Okay, so it tells you that Sanjib is winning. He bets heads. He's winning most of the time. Now, so there's a sequence of heads, tails, and you translate into this plot. Suppose you look at it in the time reversed way. Is that an equally valid sequence of heads and tails? Yes, it is. So therefore, in this plot itself, he says, do the exercise, print this out, take a ruler, and plot this. Okay, because you're starting there. And you'll find very, very few reversals. I mean, it's just pointing out. There are some 6 or 7 only in this tossing of 10,000.
In this, we are still seeing the normal distribution emerge. Because
the normal distribution tells you about the probability of getting a heads or a tails.
Right.
And that is very well respected. Good. This is technology. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. So he's done it. Okay, now all we need is a long pointer to put, but doesn't matter here. So imagine this is, see, now you have to shift here because you're starting there. So you put your pointer here. There's no change of lead till this point. So 4,000 steps have passed without changing the lead. Then, okay, I suppose the lead changes here somewhere. He's counted and he says there are 7 changes of lead. So it's a little stupefying. So central limit theorem always holds for, you know, how many heads and how many tails. But once you build up a lead, central theorem limit theorem doesn't apply to leads. It applies to tosses. Yeah. But I was trying to find that sentence. See, as you said, a startling example is obtained by looking at the same graph in reverse direction. Theoretically, the series as graphed and the reverse series are equally legitimate as representatives of an ideal random walk. Yeah, so he goes through the details of the walk. Okay, now here, this is my sampling of expert opinion revealed that even trained statisticians expect much more than 78 changes of sign in 10,000. So apparently, when you do it the old way, you have 78 changes. This way, and nobody counted on the possibility of only 8 changes. There are only 8. Actually, the probability of not more than 8 changes of sign exceeds 0.14. So in 14% of all games that you play, there won't be more than 8 reversals. There'll be fewer than 8 reversals. Remember that graph is like that. Whereas the probability of more than 78 changes of sign is only 0.12. Only 12% will have more than 78. Okay. As far as the number of changes of sign is concerned, the two records stand on par, this and the reverse. And theoretically, neither should cause surprise. If they seem startling, This is due to a faulty intuition. Please revise it. Okay. And to our having been exposed to too many vague references to a mysterious law of averages. Okay. Let's stop this. Thanks. Okay. So there it is. Thank you. Thanks, Sunny, for arranging this. This was instructive. Okay. Now, Reed Feller for many things. I mean, see, one of the things he has is many, many applications, you know, and that's actually very nice because, you know, it tells you that these ideas are very widespread. Now, actually, so after the lecture, somebody asked me about games and this and that. See, of course, heads and tails perhaps doesn't require special skill. But suppose there's a game which requires a slight amount of skill. Okay, so then will this hold? The answer is no. Well, because it will depend on who's more skillful. But how do you put that in these terms? Well, so let's say it's something like this, except there's a small bias. So the, for instance, I mean, the coin itself might be biased. Or, you know, in this language, or somebody is a little more skilled. But if somebody is a little more skilled, will he always win? Answer is no, because there's chance also. So this is where our discussion of the biased random walk comes in. Because there's a time, there's a crossover time beyond which drift takes over. So skill is like, the difference of skill is like drift. I mean, if it's zero, then it's diffusive. If it's very small, then for a long time, you'll see these long leads. But after a while, this drift will come in and the skillful fellow will win. So there is justice after all. But the game has to be long enough. How long? Well, we figured out yesterday. So, you know, by imaginative use of modeling, you can actually describe many situations via the random walk. Now, what was it that I wanted to do today? Okay, yes. So I'll try to do a very quick three, four minute summary of everything we did in the last lecture. And actually, the most important result to remember is just this, this two meanings of this quantity U2N. You remember U2N was defined as 1 over 2 raised to 2N, 2N CN. Meaning number one, probability of return to origin at time 2n. You agree with this? This is the straightforward meaning of U2n. But, and this is what we proved, this is also equal to probability of never returning to origin up to and including time 2n. This is not obvious. It required proof. And we went through the proof in this A, B, C, D. Okay. So this was a proof. I mean, it was not, the proof was not hard, but it required proving. But the fact is that these two are the same. And this is quite amazing. And this is why this quantity U2n keeps appearing in the book of Feller, even if you pass this chapter. It's somehow central. Okay. As a result of this, we easily found the probability to be at the origin for the first time, F first, at time 2n. It was given by U2n minus 2 minus U2n. So there was a question after the class as to, you know, why is this true? It is true. And the best way to think about it, or to think about any questions in probability, is to think about successes and trials. And think in those terms, and you think in terms of events. What is the event, what is the set of events which contribute to this? What is the set of events which contribute to this? What is the difference between them? And if you do that, you'll find that the only events which are different are the ones in which the walker is back at the origin, and that's exactly what you want. Okay, so that's what I want. The arcsine law also involved U, and that said that the inner game of length 2n, game length, last lead change happened at 2k. Probability of that was alpha k, what did we call it, 2k, given a game of length 2n, and that was equal to 1 over n, no, sorry, it's the product of the u's, u to k, u to n minus 2k, which we saw is like 1 over n, some function of x equal to k by n, and this function was 1 over pi, 1 over root x into 1 minus x. Okay. So this was the arcsine law for long leads. And there were two slightly surprising things about this, slightly or overwhelmingly, depending on you. One is that this function is symmetric. Thank you. Okay. We'll show these as well. One is that the function is symmetric in the sense that x near 0 and near 1, it behaves the same way. It says that the leads may have changed early, they may have, it's more likely that they'll, and of course to plot the function, which I should do, this is half, this is 0, this is 1, and there it is. I mean, maybe it's not that low, but I don't know. So there's a divergence. Can probability densities diverge? Yes. But they should be integrable. The integral under this whole curve should still be 1. So fortunately, you know, this is integrable. But it still says that, you know, here are your most likely things. And, you know, so you may reach different conclusions on whether, okay, so that is the first thing. The second thing is, you know, some of you will find that it's very unlikely to have the, you know, it's not unlikely, it's actually true, but it's very strange to imagine the lead actually changing right in the beginning. Some others of you will find that it's very strange to find the lead changing towards the end. But this is the right answer. Okay, so this is what it is. And as Professor Sabhapandit pointed out, this same function, this arcsine function, enters into many, many other properties. For instance, if you just take this Feller plot and you ask, what is the total, don't care about game and who's winning and who's losing, just find number of heads minus number of tails. No, wait on, I guess not.
Number of heads.
No, not number.
Fraction of
no, fraction of time if somebody is winning. Yeah, okay. So in other words, don't talk about leads, but how often is one person winning with respect to the other? Okay, that probability is also given by the arcsine thing. But just as a simple modification of that, if you insist on a game, in other words, so the probability that A is winning or B is winning. So, you know, I'm not exactly sure on the question to be asked, but this is the answer. This is the answer to an unspecified question. Okay, all right. But you can ask, what happens to this distribution if you have games in which you have exactly as many heads as tails? See, anyway, we expect about as many heads as, but there's some leeway. If you do that, Feller answers that question also. He calls this the equidistribution theorem. And the answer in that case is looks quite different, but still it's this. It's exactly the same. So anything is equally likely. If you insist that the number of heads is zero. The significant point is that it's a function of this variable, you know, and that's the first thing. Okay, so I think that concludes my revision. Okay, somebody else asked me, what is the significance of not returning to the origin? You know, why are we so obsessed with return to, you know, origin? So, well, I mean, you can think of one. I don't know if it's a very physical example, but at least to think about it. So, your walkers have all left. They were non-interacting walkers. They've about 10,000 of them. They've been sort of let loose from the origin. Now, suddenly, the origin says they've all gone away. Okay, I'll show them. If they come back, each person will be shot. So then what it's like a trap. So if you ask for the mean survival time, that's the time of return. So one of the sad results would be Pollier's result, that in time everybody will, because there's a with probability one, you will be returning to the origin. But then there's hope from the return side. Yes, but after the mean lifetime of everybody will be infinite. So, you know, it goes both ways. It's not a very physics result, but you can imagine some situations where something is a trap and, you know, or the other. Okay. All right, so that is that. And I was in the middle, I think, of working out this fourth re-derivation of the non-interacting single random walk problem. And let me quickly get back to that, because that will give us a spring to go to interacting systems immediately. So in fact, we set up this matrix formalism with a master equation to describe a single problem, and that was the problem of a biased random walk. And just to remind you, we had a system with periodic boundary conditions 1, 2, 3, up to L sites going around, and we had a single walker more likely to move right than left. We wrote down the matrix that describes the time evolution, and it was minus U plus V, minus U plus V everywhere. And then there's a V and a U, V, V, V. There's a U, U, U. There's a U and a V. And as we noticed, column sums were zero. And that immediately translated into the left eigenvector being 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. That can be read off. We proved a number of things, at least asserted them. Almost all were proved. And so I won't go through those things again, that the real part, okay, so the matrix we called H, we wrote it as nu, lambda nu, nu right, nu left. The real part of lambda nu's are all less than or equal to zero. There is only one state, namely 0R with eigenvalue 0, and it is the steady state. So we showed that A, that it is steady, it doesn't change, B, that it is approached in the long time limit from any arbitrary starting state. So this is an important result. I'll remind you that about the condition for orthonormality of eigenvectors. What does the orthonormality condition say? It says that nu left prime, nu prime left, nu r is equal to delta nu nu prime. Right eigenvectors from one to the other need not be orthogonal. Left eigenvectors on their own need not be, but the left with the right has to be orthogonal. So I'll just remind you. This is just nothing to do with this matrix, but a general point. And okay, so these were the sort of general properties we had, but I wanted to actually complete the exercise of you know, finding the eigenvectors of this matrix. Well, so the first thing you notice is that this one has translational invariance. You know, every point is like any other. And the moment you have translational invariance, the first thing you should try just blindly is Fourier transforms. You know, e to the iq something. And in fact, that works. So the right eigenvector I'll just write the rth matrix, element of the eigenvector is simply e to the iqr. When q is 0, we get 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. But these are probabilities, so to normalize, we'll just put in a 1 over L. The left eigenvectors have to be orthonormal to this. So it's easy to guess that they are e to the minus iq prime, iqr. Okay? Periodic boundary conditions demands that q be 2 pi some integer times L. So m equal to 1, 2, 3 up to L. Okay. Actually, I should have said this before the orthonormality, but all right. Okay. Okay, good. So given all this, we can work out whatever we want. So let's work out the object that we always concentrated on through this matrix root. I'll just change the site to R, R and T. The probability, so we are still releasing the walker from the origin at time 0, and we're asking for the probability to be at site R at time T. So how would we find it in this matrix way? Well, we have an initial column vector. What would it be? It would be 0 everywhere except at site origin. So the initial vector would be 1 at the origin and 0, 0, 0, 0 everywhere else. It's just in configuration space. This is the initial vector P of 0. Right? So P of 0, of time 0 is this. Okay. And then we know we have to evolve through this H. Okay, so let's just do this. So what we have is P, the initial vector, which we have. We have e to the ht. That will give us the full time evolution, but we want to project that to site r. So this is what we want to do. This will give you this probability. Okay, so there we go. So we'll just now do our blind sum over nu r e to the lambda nu t will come out. Okay, but let it be now. New left p0. Right? Okay, so this, as usual, will give you 1, because 1, 1, 1, 1 multiplied by this conservation probability. This will come out, and you're left with just this. So here we are. I forgot to write down what the lambda nu is. We actually had it yesterday, so let me put it back up there. Where was it? Yeah, so lambda q was equal to u e to the minus iq plus v e to the iq minus u plus v. Okay, that was supposed to be, you know, some of the things we had yesterday. So here we are then. So we have a 1 over L now. Sum over Q. Nu is Q. E to the lambda QT. This matrix element gives you E to the IQR, or minus one of them, IQR probably, the right eigenvector, R. And this gives you 1. So that's the answer. Okay, let's see what it gives you. So this gives you the integral, in the thermodynamic limit. This goes over into 1 over 2 pi integral dq e raised to this and that. Okay, we sort of go back and appeal to what you learnt in college. What is e to the ix? Cos x plus I sin x. Whose formula is that? Sorry? Euler? I thought it's de Moivre. Huh? Okay, we'll listen to you. What is it?
If you raise e to the power ix to some power n, then you can put that n into
cos n theta. Yeah. So that is who? That is de Moivre. Is that Euler or de Moivre?
Okay,
back and forth. Okay, all right. Doesn't matter, but you, okay, fine. We learnt it as de Moivre, so anyway. So that's what we'll do, you know, expand away, gather terms that I leave you all to do. So then you get, and then you put things together nicely. What do you get? You get I times Q. We'll pull out IQ because that's there. R minus U minus V sin Q over Q because we pulled out a Q. Yeah, just one sec. Times T minus U plus V. This is all in the exponent into 1 minus cos Q times T. Yes. You're right, it's not. No, it is, right? We showed that yesterday. Okay, yeah. For the left eigenvector. Yeah, right. So this is not quite 1, is it? Ah, that's right, you're right. Because we started at the origin. Thank you, Sanjeev. Yeah, I forgot about that. So what is it? The matrix element here is e to the iqr, but r is 0. So that's why it's 1. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Good. So now, here we are. So this is an answer. Let's ask for this at large times. But at large times, this is damping down. So the only thing that will contribute here is small q. So we can expand this in powers in q. You restrict it to small q, and we can expand this also to in powers of q. So at large times, because time is large and therefore we consider only q small, we are forced to the form 1 over 2 pi integral, etc., e to the minus half u plus v q squared t plus I q r minus c hat of t. Okay, where c hat is essentially related to u minus v. Okay, anyway, so you go through it and do the Fourier. This is a Fourier transform of a shifted Gaussian. Complete the square and do it, and you'll get your old answer back again. So it's e to the minus half r minus c hat t squared over u plus v times t, which is also equal to e to the minus x minus ct squared over 4 dt, provided you put in the right factors of a, which I haven't done so far. Put them in and you'll get this. Sorry? C tilde we got because sine q over q goes to 1. Yeah, q is forced to 0 because of this term. When time is large, if q is large, this goes to 0 very rapidly. Suppose q is not small, then this is finite. But then this t is very, very large. So e to the minus finite times t goes to 0 very quickly. So given a t, there's only a certain small range of q which will contribute. So because t is large, q must be small. Because q is small, this is 1. Okay. So this is the answer, and here you can, so I mean, I won't go through the translation again, like U is equal to P times R naught, et cetera, et cetera. And C is equal to C hat times A, et cetera. So D is half R naught A squared. Don't confuse this R naught with the R. R is a space variable, R naught is the rate. Okay. I mean, all right, but the fact is that we have it back again, and we have it through this matrix route. My purpose in doing this was not to derive the answer, we knew, but to show you something about these, this sort of formalism, to discuss time development of the system. Okay, can I rub this out now? Okay, let me rub this out, this side. Okay, so at this point, let's in fact start discussing interacting systems. And we won't, you know, so sometimes you might say, okay, I've discussed one particle, so now let me start with two, and then let me start with three, and then jump to infinity. We won't do that, we'll just go to an infinite number of particles straight off. Okay, so what are we going to do? So let's deal with a large system with many particles and with some interaction. The interaction, just as an example you can keep in mind, is exclusion. So imagine that we have that same system with many, many, except that we have many random workers now. So this is full, that is full, maybe that is full. And let's say we attempt to move forward with rate u and backward with rate v, but we can complete a hop only if the site is empty. Like if the site is full and you attempt a hop, that is not allowed. Because the rule is that you can have at most one particle per site. You could have nothing, but you could have at most one. So the first thing, you know, when confronted with any problem is to ask what are the configurations. So the configurations are specified by the occupancies. So if I have I equal to 1, 2, 3 up to L, and you give me ni, ni is 1 here, 1 here, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, etc. That is the specification of the configuration. So the configuration C is specified by the occupancies. Let's suppose the system has L sites, n particles. How many configurations are there? NCR. That's LCN, actually. LCN, yeah, is the number of configurations. How does that grow with L for fixed value of n by L? Answer, it grows exponentially. Suppose n is L by 2. Roughly speaking, how does it grow? 2 to the L. Yeah, I mean, with some prefactors, but essentially 2 to the L. All right, doesn't matter. Okay, so here we are. So we have this. So we have a very large space of configurations. When we had a single random walk, a single random walker, how many configurations did we have? L, because where the particle is specified. Now we have e raised to L, hugely larger. So how can we ever deal with this? Well, it's not so hard. Well, so let's just think about it. So basically you have, okay, so we'll go back to that example once in a while, but here let me write down something more general. So we have to imagine a picture, and this is the best way to think about it. That you have configurations all over the place. So here's one configuration C, and here's a bunch of others, you know, whole lot of them. Okay. How is this going to evolve in time? Well, the question is, what is going to evolve? And as usual, the answer is going to be the probability. So we are after the probability of knowing something about the probability of having a configuration C. So we'll write an equation for this. And this equation will be exactly the same as the one we wrote earlier. Namely, there's a sum over C prime not equal to C, W C prime to C slightly different notation from what I use, but just bear with me. This is a little more general. P of C prime minus W C to C prime P of C. So just stare at it. So we have this vast space of configurations, and we are asking for the probability of this configuration C to be there at time t. Okay, suppose it's there. How is it changing in time? What is the rate of change? It can change because there are transitions to it, and it can increase because there are transitions to it, and it can decrease because transitions away. So if you like, we can draw some bunch of transitions in. Maybe these go in, and some configurations don't connect at all. Then, of course, there are also transitions out. For instance, this may lead out here. So it leads out. Maybe this leads out there as well. You know, there's no guaranteeing what will happen. So ultimately, in that full space, you have a very complicated network of connections. Right. Now, this is all very well to write in the abstract. What does it mean, let's say, in terms of the process we described? Here, let's say, is configuration C. Okay, let me draw it here. Suppose there are these particles, and this is maybe periodic. Suppose we have just three particles. Okay, what is an example of something that can happen here, which will lead out of this configuration? Something can hop. For instance, this could hop here. So suppose it hopped, that would take it to this configuration. So this would be an example. So this is C, this is C prime. It's going away from C to C prime. It could be this. On the other hand, it's possible that C prime, you know, first of all, note that this might have hopped, or this might have hopped here, or that might. Each one will generate a different configuration. So in this array, you're picking out different arrows. Okay. Likewise, you can imagine a whole lot of configurations which could lead into this. Example, for instance, if you had the configuration, this could have hopped there, and that would have led to C. So this configuration feeds into that. Okay, so that is the meaning of all this, you know, very abstract drawing. It's actually very down to earth. Something can happen, and that changes the configuration. Okay, now that's all very good. So this is the general formalism. It's like saying that we can write down the Schrodinger equation for a many particle system. Yes, but now can we do something about it? Yeah, question. Yeah. Yeah, it could be zero. The rate of hopping from W to C prime might be zero. So many of these W's might be zero. It's not necessary. Quite right. Yeah. So given any two configurations, most likely they will not even be connected at all. If they're connected, the connection may be one way. It may be that it's two way. Yeah. Okay, good. But now, what can we say about this business? Well, the first thing is we will have to, you know, we need to ask what is it that we want. Okay, and the answer is that let's ask for steady state. Okay. What is the steady state of this system? So let me write it here. Steady state. Notice that you could write this, you know, as we did even earlier, P of C and T. Let's say the full vector P of T. It's a very long vector, but e to the h t P of 0. So that's still true. We can integrate this. It's still true that 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 is the left eigenvector. But the corresponding right eigenvector is what we are after, because that is the steady state. That will tell us the assignment of probabilities two configurations in the steady state. Question? That's correct. In this example, it has to be exactly like that. It depends on what your physical example is. So if I'm considering nearest neighbor hopping with exclusion, then it has to be of that sort. You might want to consider nearest and next nearest neighbor hopping. In that case, it will expand the possibilities. Okay. So is the general setup or scenario clear? Okay. What are we after? It's like, as I said in the Schrodinger equation, we want the ground state of a many particle system of interacting electrons, interacting via the Hubbard interaction in a magnetic field, whatever. Specify it, and you Schrodinger equation, easy to write. Master equation, easy to write. Ground state, not easy to find. So P of finding the steady state in general is the first problem you need to solve. Except that we know that, you know, all this work of Boltzmann and Gibbs and all, and they told us what the probabilities are. It's e to the minus beta e. So somewhere there should be a special role for equilibrium systems, and we'll come to that. But at the moment, we won't do that. So what is the steady state in general? We want dpc by dt to be equal to 0 for all c. Because then the probability doesn't change. That's what we mean by steady, right? How can we guarantee that? Well, you can't do much except to write the condition that is obvious from here, that the sum over C prime of W C prime to C P C prime must equal sum over C prime P of C to C prime. The only slight thing I can do on the right hand side is, sorry, W, and I can just pull out P of C common here, but neither here nor there. Okay, so this must be true because this is the right hand side of this equation, and all it expresses is that the total current in, by current I mean the probability current in phase space, should equal the total current out. Yeah.
So why is it for all C? Because I would expect that steady state is represented for some particular combination, some particular configuration, right?
No. I mean,
so then this to me,
steady state, the state,
yes,
is not the same as configuration. So okay, every configuration has its own little chance of being in the steady state, I mean of being sampled in the steady state. So what we want, by when we say steady state, we mean P steady state C1. I should have put the subscript SS. This is in steady state. It's this vector we want. And none of them should change in time, and that is why SS. Okay? All right. So this is a steady state for you. But there is, of course, a very important class of steady states, and we can't forget about them. And those are equilibrium states. So equilibrium right. So for instance, if you think in let me just not go backward. Okay, let's just go forward. So what is steady state saying? It says take a configuration, there's some current in and there's some current out, and the two are equal. Equilibrium says there are no currents. Currents are zero everywhere. Okay, so that is the statement of equilibrium. I mean, if you like, in real space also, if you have electrons and a wire carrying a current, they're in steady state, they're not in an equilibrium state. Currents almost always are non-equilibrium. I mean, they're non-equilibrium. But at least a necessary condition for steady state is that there should be no currents. And in fact, here this is it. because this is considering all sorts of currents in phase space. So equilibrium is the condition of no current, but no current between any pair of configurations. So let's say this is C prime. Of course, there are transitions, but the total net flux here should balance the net flux there. They're balanced. So therefore, the difference between them is zero. This must be. It's a rather detailed condition between every pair of configurations. So we must have no net current, no net flux, let's say, or let me avoid the word current because that has a real space connotation, between any pair. So how can this happen? One easy way in which it can happen is that there are no connections between C and C prime, so nothing can exchange. No transitions. That's possibility A. But possibility B is that, you know, in case there are transitions, it must be that WC prime to C, PC prime is equal to WC to C prime, P of C, for every pair of these. As I said, it's a detailed sort of condition, and so this condition is actually called detailed balance. Okay. So of course you can divide one by the other, and sometimes people like to do that. So W, I don't know which way to write it, WC prime to C divided by WC to C prime is equal to P of C divided by P of C prime. So this is the condition of detailed balance. Now historically, the condition of detailed balance has been used in two ways. You know, in the old days when people actually started to model this, Glauber's paper, not on, with apologies to Sadiq, it's on the Ising model. not on coherent states. Okay, so it was, you know, in the 60s, 70s, people were, you know, they were working with equilibrium systems which had interesting properties like the Ising model. But they wanted to study the dynamics. So they knew to start with what the probabilities were. They were given by the Boltzmann-Gibbs e to the minus bt. So what they did is they said that detailed balance must be valid. Therefore, we will construct W's such that it is respected, and it's possible to do. Glauber did it. If there's time, we'll also show you what he did later. But later, as time went by, people began to expand the scope of what they looked at, and they began to look at problems defined not in terms of energies of configurations, but in terms of processes. You know, this can go if this is possible, this can annihilate if this happens, etc., etc. Legitimate models. This is a different way of modeling. And then in that case, you are not sure what the steady state will be. Will it be an equilibrium state or not? Okay, so then it became all the more important to understand what equilibrium is and then work accordingly. Okay, good. Yeah, no, so we are assuming that they are, not directly, but indirectly. So this is the point that, for instance, in this system, if you asked for a configuration in which this particle is moved by 2 units, that is not connected directly. That is what I meant by no direct transitions. But in fact, you can easily prove that every configuration can be reached from every other. In other words, the system is ergodic in the space of n particles. You could, of course, take the point of view that actually, you know, I could have any number of particles, in which case you have a 2 to the n by 2 to the n system, But then, of course, what you will have is blocks with 2 to the L by 2 to the L. So, here you would have, I should have drawn a smaller block. You know, this could be the ordinary single random walk block, just one particle. Then there could have been 2 particles or 3, and every configuration here is connected to every other. So, these are like invariant subspaces. So, does that answer the question? Anyway, what I meant here is no direct transition. I mean, okay. So, any other question?
Given a system, so W is defined for it, right? W is like the Hamiltonian.
Yeah, the modeling is done through W's, let's say.
And P of C, that gives you the state.
P of C is the things that we want to find.
Yeah, so and you start with some initial condition.
Correct. That will evolve. P of C, that whole complexion will evolve and then it will stop evolving.
Exactly. And so if it obeys this condition retained balance, then you call it equilibrium.
Yes. That's for the moment you can take it as true. Yeah, I mean it's a definition almost.
Okay.
All right. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
And if dp by dt for all P of C is 0, then you call it steady state.
Yeah, clearly equilibrium is a special case of steady state because once you guarantee every bracket in this thing 0, you are guaranteeing the left hand side 0.
Yes.
So, it is a subclass, it is a very important subclass.
Yes. So, in this picture on a ring basically, U and East are the rates of hopping from the left and right.
Correct.
So, if they are unequal,
yes.
Then maybe I would expect some current to flow in one direction.
No, no, I mean you don't even have to think too much. You can go from C to C prime with rate U, you can come back with rate V.
Yes.
The U is not equal to V, this is does not satisfy detailed balance.
Yeah, it doesn't satisfy.
Yeah,
detail.
Yeah.
But doesn't mean that it doesn't go into a steady state. Detailed balance?
No, certainly it will go into a steady state, yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly. So it will go into a steady state.
That's right.
So, and in the steady state, I will expect some current in the
yes.
direction or
quite
direction.
Right. That's right. Quite right. And one of the objectives will be to work out that current at some point. Yeah.
This is somewhat like, okay, no, I don't know physically how this comes from, but this reminds me of persistent current in this quantum system.
No. I mean, this is the one thing I should just explicitly say, you know, I'm using this bracket notation, which and I'm using H, but this is not quantum mechanics.
Yeah.
This is stochastic,
yeah.
Classical stochastic mechanics.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you want physical examples, I mean, you can, there are several. For instance, in ionic channels which go through membranes, the ions actually cannot surpass each other. So, there is an exclusion. And Prabal Maiti, amongst others, is working on this aspect, I think. You know, maybe not in ionic channels, but in some confined thing where he is actually looking at this. And there are several other examples which I won't get into now. Manas, do you know any? No. No, okay, all right. Yes.
Perhaps a pretty idiotic question, but is it possible
Good.
From to go from one steady state to another steady state via the equilibrium or being arbitrarily close to the equilibrium but not getting locked in?
Well, let me drop out the latter half of your question. Is it possible to go from one steady state to the other? The answer on a finite system is no, there is only one steady state. Okay. But as you take the limit of a very large system, it could be that steady state, I mean, for instance, I'm thinking of something like phase separation. Suppose you have 2 phases, you know, and on a very large time scale, one phase will become the other, will become the. So that is why I said in a finite system, the steady state is one and unique. The steady state may actually have the property. So remember, we are talking only about probabilities in a Poincaré time. Okay? We're not talking about the sequence of configurations. The sequence of configurations defines the dynamics, which is very interesting. So if you had a phase separated state, that would survive very, very, very long. And then something will happen, some interface will sweep across, you'll go to the other phase. And that will survive very long. So in a finite system, since you've taken such a long time stretch, you'll average over those. But in an infinite system, so it depends on order of limit. L going to infinity first, then time going to infinity, or the reverse. Yeah. Yeah, no, but why are you so upset with the order of limits? Yeah. No, no, so this is what I was trying to say, that depending on your time scale, suppose you have something happening for a long, long, long time. Then there's a switch and something else happens for a long, long, long time. So you might use a description that you're going from one steady state to the other, but actually it's not. It is a change of configuration. So that's the right point of view. But, depending on time scale, you may not be interested in that, that's not. So that's the only sense in which it could be. But in reality, as we have asserted, can be proved, maybe we'll prove it at some point, otherwise look up Van Kampen, the steady state is unique, given a stochastic matrix. Okay? So we'll ignore what Sadiq said about close to equilibrium and getting trapped, as if equilibrium is a bad thing. Okay, all right. So let's, one of the things you all have to learn is to give talks and give lectures. Now just imagine the situation 15 to 20 years from now. Okay, I'll be some big age if I'm there at all. And this Raman Research Institute will be going on, and these two gentlemen will still be organizing the school, but that you all will be lecturing, right? So you have better learn how to lecture. The first thing you have to learn is how to answer questions. Always adapt the question to what you want to say, and that'll give you a further chance to say what you want. It'll make you unpopular with one person, that is the questioner, but it's okay. Yeah. Anyway, so actually yesterday I was thinking about this, 100 of you here. Each of you has come with a very different time, world line. Somebody is born in Ranchi, somebody is born in Chennai, somebody is even born in Mumbai, So, and here these world lines have sort of converged into this room for 2 weeks, thanks to these two people. And then there are some six arbitrary world lines coming and talking to you all, and then they'll go away. But the most important thing you should take away from the school is each other. Because you may differ from her by 4 months and 2 days today in age. But 20 years later, you'll still be 4 months and 2 days away. You'll all evolve in the same way. So you'll keep seeing each other. So it's good that you've got to know each other. Right. So use this opportunity to actually know each other. If there are physics questions, discuss them with others. It's useful. That's one of the best things about any school. Yeah. So Deepak Dhar and I and Krishnamurti still talk about a science talent summer school, and this happened and that happened. So I hope there's some interesting other things going on in the school. Yeah. Yes. Yes, right. Said that way, it is correct. Yeah. All right, now let's proceed. Okay, how do we prove detailed balance, or how do we verify detailed balance? So there are two ways. Way A. See, what is detailed balance? I'll remind you by putting a red circle around it. A square or rectangle here. How do we find it? Now the hard thing is, so this is here you should have put equilibrium, EQ, EQ, EQ everywhere. We don't know these P's, we have to find them. So one thing you can do is just guess them. having guessed them, you just verify that this is so, and then you are through, proved. So V is guess P. And then verify that box. Okay, so let's give a simple example where we can guess P. Shall I rub this out? Yeah, I think we can. Let me consider a system of sites again. And again, particles which, I mean, each site can hold at most one particle, but it might have none. But the dynamics is the following, that something can come into the system from the outside with some rate u. On the other hand, sorry, it can't come here because it's already full, but something can come in here with rate u. And this can, so it's deposition and evaporation, each site independently. Okay? Is the system clear? There are L sites. At each site, there's a stochastic process happening. Can we find the equilibrium state? I mean, is this in equilibrium or not? We can ask. So can somebody hazard a guess? We have to make a guess, educated guess. Before guessing, we have to ask always, as a matter of discipline, ask, how many configurations are there? It's not so hard. Come on. Huh? What is n? 2 to the L, because each site could be empty or occupied. Nothing forbids anything. So the answer is there are 2 to the L configurations. So anything can happen. Okay. Now in this space of 2 to the L configurations, you want to make a guess about the steady state or equilibrium state probability. Anybody have a guess? If not, let me just proceed. Yeah, go ahead. I thought you did. No. Okay. No. All right. So let's just try the following, that we say that we have a configuration C, and suppose in that configuration there are n particles. Let's just weight it with some number z to the n. If you like, you can write this as z raised to sum over I n I. Or you can even write it as product over I z raised to n I. There are many ways to write it. Suppose this is true. So let's try it. Okay. So then what should we have? Let's try it in this form. So suppose we consider C is something with these... Okay, so here's your system and here's this particular point. C is the system without the thing, and C prime, let's say, is the rest of the system is the same, and C prime, we have a particle there. What is the transition rate to go from here to there? It's u. What is the transition rate back? It's v. Does it mean that equilibrium is not satisfied? No, it doesn't mean that. We still have to work out the current. Transition rates need not be equal. The probabilities can compensate. Okay? So suppose we demand detailed balance, what will we say? That PC prime over PC, C prime, right? So PC times U should equal U by V, if I've done it right. Just check. Yeah. Is this possible? Well, so let's try it with this prescription. But this is equal to C prime has one more particle, so it has Z. So provided we choose Z equal to U by V, we are through. Detail balance is satisfied. Some number. We didn't know it. We just tried it. It's the fugacity, actually. But you need not have known. You could have tried it. It's a trial number. So all I wanted to illustrate is, sometimes it's very possible with some experience, you'll become very good at guessing. So don't worry. So Z to the N is always a good thing to try. Mostly it won't work, but sometimes it'll work. So, okay, and what I wanted to specially illustrate is just because the rates are not the same back and forth, doesn't mean we don't have equilibrium. We do. This is simple equilibrium. Exercise. Suppose there's no restriction on the number of particles per site. You can have more than one. You can deposit another. Okay. Work out the distribution in that case. First of all, do you have equilibrium? You have to work at it. Just find out. Will Z to the N still work? Maybe it will. You have to try it. But by 4:30, try to find the answer. We have a tutorial. Okay. Yes.
Why the ratio of this 2 rate is equal to Z?
Sorry?
Why the ratio of this 2 rate is equal to Z?
Why? Okay. The logic is as follows. So here we are. This is our guess that P of C is equal to Z to the N. This is what we are trying to see. So we are postulating this. We'll see if it works. We are trying. Okay. So what are we doing? Yeah. So what we are doing is we are trying it out, and we are taking the ratio. So this is in C prime. We have some number of particles. Let's say Z to the And here then we have in C one less particle, Z to the N minus 1. So that ratio is equal to Z. So do you understand the logic? This is that with the different N.
Particle number is conserved.
No, it's certainly not conserved.
But you are comparing different configurations.
Okay. Correct. Completely many. Well, yeah, it's different. It's a different configuration, but it differs only in the occupancy of that one site. Okay, all right. So it's not so hard. Let me start again. So here's a configuration. I mean, there are some occupancies everywhere, but I'm focusing on a particular site. When that site is full, in the system we have n particles. When that site is empty, therefore, this is a function of the full configuration. When only that site is empty, nothing else changes, you have n minus 1 particles. So therefore, okay. So it was a guess. Maybe I didn't make it clear. This was a guess. So this was method A. You have to guess. Method B is a much more systematic method, and maybe David Mukamel taught you all this. Kolmogorov, did you do? No. Okay. All right. So then I will do it. And the slightly philosophically unsatisfactory part about this is that you have to guess P. I mean, actually it's a good thing. You have to, it's good to guess. But you may not be able to guess the answer. So is there something else that you can use that relies only on the rates? The answer is yes. This is a condition due to Kolmogorov. So Kolmogorov was a, great, difficult to say, mathematician, physicist of the Russian variety, and especially in probability theory, but others will say in other things, he made very fundamental contributions. But okay, so what did he do? What he said is, okay, you want to verify detail balance? Verify it. Here's the criterion. So this is called the Kolmogorov criterion. Involves only the W's, no P's. So what he says is start with the configuration C1, go to some configuration C2, only keep going, but make sure you come back to C1. C3 up to CN, finally you come back to C1. So let's consider the sequence of, so this is like a loop in configuration space. Many loops are possible, but let's consider a loop. Okay, so then he says, let's consider the transitions. So let's say WC1 to C2, C2, just multiply them out, C2 to C3, WCN to C1. And then for good measure, divide by the reverse transitions. Check whether this is 1 or not. If it is equal to 1, let's call the left hand side capital U. It depends on this whole loop. If it is 1, so this is the Kolmogorov criterion. We'll call it K for Kolmogorov, the criterion. If this is true for every loop that you can make in configuration space, everyone, each and every one, then this is a necessary and sufficient condition for detailed balance. So let us prove it. It will take 5 minutes. But are you all ready? You'll have to think a little bit. Okay. So necessary is very easy. Necessary means, what does necessary mean? That means if this is true, what does necessary mean? This implies the truth. Other way around? Oh, okay, okay. Ha, so good. That is the easy part. Yeah, so detail balance is valid. Oh, we rubbed it out. So WCN to CN plus 1 divided by WCN plus 1 to CN is equal to P of CN plus 1 divided by P of C. N. This must hold. So let's assume this is true, and then we just plug in. Nicely, we have these ratios. So this is equal to P of C2 divided by PC1, first one. Next one is PC3 divided by PC2. Last one is PC1 over PCN. Now you can entertain yourselves by putting lots of crosses. And this is equal to 1. So we've proved it is necessary. Now we have to prove it is sufficient. So necessary, answer is yes. Sufficient. Okay. So I don't want to bend, so I'll write here. Actually, for a long time, you couldn't find the reference to the Kolmogorov paper. Now, we found the reference, but we haven't been able to actually trace the paper. But it appears, this proof appears in school proceedings where David Mukamal talked about the proof. So I'm just taking it from there. Okay, but the sufficiency. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll just construct the piece. We'll construct them. Okay. So suppose we start with C1. Assign it a probability, PC1, given. Okay. We construct P of C2 by saying that this is, I have to get it the right way, right? I suppose this is C1 to C2, this is C2 to C1, P of C1. I construct it. Nobody can stop me from constructing. Like that, I'll construct PC3 also. And so on up to PCK, WC1 to C2, WC2 to C3, up to W CK minus 1 to CK divided by the inverses W C2 to C1, W C3 to C2. The P's which are constructed in this way certainly satisfy detail balance because they have been constructed like that. But is this a proof that detail balance is valid? No, because you've chosen a particular sequence of states like that, you've gone up to k, from 1 to k, 2, 3, 4, 5. But in general, there are many routes to go to k. So let's consider another route. It can even have more steps. Let's call this root A and let's call this root B. Okay. Of course, in the process, we also have a loop, by the way, notice. So, do you see the proof now? Well, so basically, B constructs this, A constructs this. So let's consider the sequence AB inverse. You come back to the same point. Kolmogorov has guaranteed that is 1. Therefore, the result of A is equal to the result of B. I have written this a little schematically. In other words, it's independent of the path. Reminds us of something in thermodynamics, right? So one of the arguments where we try to prove that entropy is a state function. Something going around giving you 0 or 1 is enough to prove path independence. It's the same thing here. Okay, so this is the answer. So Kolmogorov has given you a way to prove this. Okay. Now, is this a useful criterion? Actually, it is useful, and it's mostly useful in proving things are not in equilibrium because you quickly can find loops which will violate this, and then you can be sure, even if one loop violates this, you're sure that this is not an equilibrium state. So you can prove using this that things are not in equilibrium, and on occasion, you can even prove that things are in equilibrium. You can identify the conditions for equilibrium using this. Don't call it Hamiltonian.
Yeah.
W. You call it H, I don't mind, but it's not a Hamiltonian.
Okay.
I mean that matrix has all the information in it and it's pulling out things in a particular way. Okay, so this is a sort of the basic sort of formalism. At this point, we'll leave the basic formalism and come back to the system at hand and see what we can say about it. The system at hand being this set of particles on a ring. So I'm rubbing this out. So this is so much for the general formalism. Try to do the homework. Okay, good. All right, so let's come to this thing that's called the exclusion process. So we already have it defined up there. So we have these sites 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way around up to L. So these are particles on a ring. As we said, there are L sites and N particles. So if you like, there's a density rho given by N by L. And when we think about taking the limit L going to infinity, we'll do it in such a way that N by L is fixed. All right. Now, the first thing is let us check whether detailed balance is valid. And we'll do it by making a guess for P of C. So there are LCN configurations, and the guess is P of C is independent of C. It's equal to 1 over script n, where script n is the number of configurations. You could even actually have derived it without guessing it, because in this case you will observe that your W matrix is Hermitian. Therefore, the right eigenvector will be the same as the left eigenvector, but the left eigenvector we have already shown is all ones. Therefore, the right eigenvector must be that. But even if you had not observed this, this is easy to check, because let's consider any one transition from, I'm sorry, this is in the case U equals V. Yeah, sorry. Assume U equals V, rub out the V, call it a U. Only then this is true, because otherwise, of course, it's false. Sorry, forgot to specify. This is called the symmetric exclusion process. Okay. All right. Now, how do we verify this? Well, so let's consider a particular hop, C to C prime through a particular hop. Okay, that happens at rate U. The inverse hop also happens at rate U. So it's immediate to see that WC to C prime times P of C is equal to WC prime to C, P of C prime, because by this is equal to that, and so this is equal to that. So this is valid. Okay, so there's nothing further required here. So this is an equilibrium system. Okay. Now notice that every configuration is equally likely, is what we've said. Does that make sense? Consider the configuration in which all the n particles are on the left, and then the rest is empty. Is this as likely as a random configuration? Okay, can you justify? Yeah. Okay. No, so does anybody find it surprising? If not, I'll just proceed. No, they're all equally probable. I mean, it's a flat distribution. Every configuration is equally likely. Nevertheless, if we watch the system in time, it will not reach this configuration very often. But the system will not reach any configuration very often. It will reach it as often as 1 over n times. The reason this appears very singular is because there are not many other configurations like it. But if you have a randomly placed thing and you move one or two around, it doesn't appear that different. But they're different configurations. In fact, this is the reason why random arrangements are favored. There are many more of them. That's the only reason. Each configuration is equally likely, but the state is in fact largely a random state. Okay, all right. Now, since every configuration is equally likely, in the thermodynamic limit, it is as good as saying we have independent occupation of each site. This is not strictly true for any finite L, but in the limit L going to infinity, this is true. So it's like going from a canonical to a grand canonical ensemble. So in fact, that is what we're doing. We're going from a canonical to grand canonical. And instead of specifying the density, we could specify a fugacity. We already have some experience with fugacities now. Okay. So what I'm saying is that in that limit, in the thermodynamic limit, L going to infinity, keeping density the same, then we can write down quite easily what is the probability of a configuration Ni. And that is, in fact, by translational invariance, the same, first of all, by independence, and second, by translational invariance is the same as the product over 1 to L of separate probabilities of occupation of each set. So I'm saying, okay, I've said it, so I won't repeat. So this, okay, and what is this probability of prob NA? So you can write it in some formal way if you want. It is rho, so with the probability rho, there's an occupancy, so Kronecker delta of Ni with 1, plus with probability 1 minus rho, it is empty, so we say Kronecker delta of Ni 0. So prob is equal to this. And if you sum over the two options, you get 1. Sorry? Which delta?
No.
So remember how I've started. I started by saying, actually there are n particles with in a system of size L. So the real system does have a fixed rho. Now I'm saying, let me look at, if you like, yeah, the same system. Yeah, if you, okay, let's just leave it at that, yes. Any other question? Okay, so then if not, let's proceed. So this form is called, this is what often you'll find that people will say, oh, you have product measure. So this is what they mean, that the writing the probability of the full configuration factorizes into a product, and that is called the product measure. Measure simply means weight. Okay, so much for the symmetric case. Let's do the analogous quick calculation in exactly 2.5 minutes for the asymmetric case. So it's called the asymmetric simple exclusion process. S stands for simple. It does not stand for asymmetric AS, you know. All right, good. So in this case, we have WC to C prime is not equal to WC prime to C. Okay. So this Hamiltonian, or sorry, I did what I said you must never do. The W matrix is not Hermitian. Nevertheless, the right eigenvector is 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. So observe, however, a 1 over n, 1 over n everywhere is the right eigenvector still, with eigenvector 0, with eigenvalue 0. How will we prove this? This is the steady state. We can't prove detailed balance, obviously, because with equal things it won't work. But we'll just verify that the total current in is equal to the total current out from any configuration C. So to do that, in this case, we'll invoke a condition which is somewhat special but sometimes works. It's called pairwise balance. And the pair in this pairwise balance is not configurations but transition probabilities. So what pairwise balance in a general sense means is the following, that C, let's isolate all the things going out from C. There's some particular transition going from C to C prime. Now, again, it's a bit of a guess or construction. You have to, if you are lucky and you can find a configuration C double prime somewhere, which goes into C at exactly the same, with the same flux as from C to C prime. In other words, C double prime is a function of C and C prime. Given an out transition C to C prime, can you find a unique C double prime that leads into this. Then for every C prime going, you will have another C double prime, and then total in will balance total out. It has to be unique. But in this case, actually, it does happen. So would you, I'm not writing it in words. Maybe we'll do that next time since we have, can I complete this proof? 2 minutes, won't take long. Okay, so how do we use this? So let's look at a typical configuration C. So that has these particles and holes and particles in some way. Okay, so let's think about it. Particles can hop out. We want to go from C to C prime. So this is configuration C. So let's consider a generic C prime in which, let's say, this guy has hopped out, suppose. Let me draw it here because I'm going to draw C prime below. Okay, so the first thing is you notice if there's a cluster of particles, this can happen at the edge of a cluster. Let's say it happens at the right edge, then this would be with probability u that it hopped out. What is the configuration C prime that results? It's this, the particle has moved. Nothing else has changed. So this is C prime, and there's a transition rate u which goes from here to there. Question, can we construct a C double prime through an algorithm such that C double prime feeds into C at the same rate u? And it should be done in a way that won't duplicate C double prime. The answer is not very hard. You look at that particle cluster. Look at the leftmost particle there. And since it's the edge of the cluster, the site next to it must be empty. So construct C double prime by moving that particle there. So here we are. So these two are unchanged. But this is moved. This will become empty. This will become full. And the rest will be unchanged. Then obviously, this configuration leads into this with the same rate u, because this can hop there. Yes, because consider a cluster. I mean, by unique, I mean there's a definite way to build it, and there's nothing else that will result in this C double prime. Because it's contingent on the definition of cluster. Given a configuration, the clusters are specified. Something at the edge of a cluster will move. If that is moving, go to the other edge of the cluster and move. That is also, so given this, this is a unique prescription. All right, so then this is satisfied. For every C to C prime transition, we can construct a C double prime such that this happens. Therefore, the sum over, you know, out rates is equal to the sum over all in rates, and you're through. Yeah, okay. Of course, you could have said, oh, but you know, who said this will move with the rate u? Maybe, you know, to start with, this could have moved there with rate v. Okay, but go to the other edge of the cluster. Do the same there. That will move in with rate v. So it's simple. I'm sure there are other proofs of the fact that this is a steady state, but this is a proof that works in a number of instances. No, can you repeat? No, but remember, this is a cluster. It has to, I mean, cluster is defined by sequential occupancies of particles, and then, you know, that's it. And then the next thing has to be a hole, by definition. In the extreme case, you have everything in one cluster. but you still have a cluster. I mean, the definition of cluster is that plus the holes. Okay, I think we can stop now. It would have been nice to proceed further, but we will do it next time. But observe that since 1111 is a thing, this will still be valid. And since this is valid, probabilities of occupancies on different sites will factorize, and you'll be able to compute the current very easily. Okay, I think we'll leave it at that. We'll carry on at 4:30. 4:30, I suppose, is not compulsory for people to come, no? I mean, are you all taking attendance? No. All right. But come. All right. Yeah. Okay. You all have worked out the problems. No? Today's, it doesn't matter if you haven't worked out, but yesterday's three problems. Yeah.